after 100 years and after having experienced so many different critical events, that they seem to still weather the storm and seem to be very robust in the sense that they are stable, emotionally stable, that they are very practical, down-to-earth people who can have a good time and can have a lot of humor, in spite of the fact that their vision and their hearing or their mobility may not be working as well anymore as it used to. They know how to cope with life. They know how to deal with adversity. That can also be a great model for younger individuals. No single result that we have describes all centenarians. There are great individual differences. People are at 100 as unique as people might be, or maybe even more unique, as they might be at 20 or 30 or 40. So when we make statements about our centenarians, we need to be cautious not to even generalize for all of our centenarians, not alone, to talk about all centenarians in the United States or in the world. There is no recipe of longevity. There may be a recipe book where you could have different types of recipes that may help one for one person, another for another person. So while we all like to make these general statements and try to say, this is what we have found, this finding will always be only true for a certain percentage of centenarians, but not for all of them.
In our phase one, we look at differences, and there are certain limitations, such as people born at different time could have impact on the results. Now we're looking at change over time. What are the advantages of looking at change?
We kind of like to assume that people are always going to be the same, but that is not the truth. There are gains and there are losses throughout life. And so from the aging perspective, of course, we want to address those particular changes, to understand how an organism, a person, an individual changes over time, and what it means for that particular person. A good example is health. We all want to always stay in perfect health, but it's not going to be that way.
There are advantages and disadvantages of having a convenient sample in our phases one and two. Now we switch to phase three.
Phase three then included participants who would not only live in the community, but would also live in nursing homes and long-term care settings or in assisted living facilities. And we would also include participants who would have a relatively low cognitive functioning. And so we are opening the door to an entirely new group of centenarians that at least the Georgia Centenarian Study had not studied before. And so it's a natural progression from looking at the top performance group to include the entire scale of functioning among centenarians. It would help us understand not only another group of centenarians, but perhaps to make predictions of why it is that some people do so well at 100, something that we found out in phase one and phase two, and why it is that some people do not do so well, and perhaps to distinguish those different patterns of behaviors in midlife. Studying individuals who are cognitively impaired is very difficult to do. I cannot ask, any questions that need some form of reasoning, that rely on some form of memory. I may not be able to rely on an answer, even if I get an answer. So one way to adjust for that is that we've also included family members, proxy informants, who can help us with some answers of centenarians who cannot tell us what their life is like, or who cannot comprehend what we're asking them about their lives. I think it's quite an exciting piece of our work, because hopefully in the end we will be able to find some or suggest some pathways that help us determine what you have to do in order to not only live long, but to live very, very well.